To your right. Get it, Jake.
Damn.
Anything?
No, not enough.
Let's take what we got back to the truck. We're running out of time. Jake?
Kill 5-4.
KQB 755, Unit 1 to base.
How's it look, Dan?
Dynamite, we got tonight's lead.
What you've got is less than 20 minutes.
So we skip our coffee break. JC, you're gonna love these pics. It looks like the whole building is coming down.
Let's do it.
And you're not listening to me. You listen, but you don't hear. 17 minutes to newscast.
Can I picture on
this? The lineup is all set. I'll have to get new coffee.
Then you'll have to hurry, yeah?
Lose time, Dan. Don't do this to me.
You get the hell out of here.
30 seconds.
You give him 30 seconds and hose him.
You're fired for me.
Damn it, tell him we'll leave with the World's Fair piece. He can tease the fire in the intro.
We're going to Terry's piece first, old intro, but tease the fire.
Late breaking on the lakeshore, Seth.
Stand by, Seth.
What's the matter, Ann? I get you some of the best footage I've ever gotten.
40 seconds too late.
It made it to air, didn't it?
It was supposed to be the lead. I overruled my producer on your say-so.
It was
you
happening.
You didn't deliver, Jake.
I had to go with it.
Go home and have a shower with it.
Who you? Back!
Oh, yeah, Dan, I see him.
Yeah, they're in there.
Open it!
Ugly-looking dude with a gun. It's going down right now.
Come on, Tony, come on, man, come on!
Yeah, yeah. No one moves, no one gets hurt.
Tony! What the hell are you doing?
Everybody saw it. We're fried, Tony. Our pictures are right there, right on the damn TV.
Bastard. You gave us to the cops, man. You're finished.
No, Tony, don't. It's too late. We got nowhere to go.
We're going out of here. And once I waste this sucker, they'll know we mean business.
Now, how are you going to get a camera in here? Huh?
Jake's on the phone. He wants us to put a camera in there. Go live.
Live? In a hostage situation, that'd be different.
Tell him, man.
So go for it.
Great story. Fabulous.
Jake's on the line for this one, Ann. Guy's gonna blow him away if we don't go along with it.
Then we gotta do it.
God wants an answer, man.
Just a minute!
Come in!
No!
Oh, you bastards! I'm on there in 30 seconds or he's dead!
Where's Jessica?
The incredible true story of an 18-month-old girl trapped down an abandoned water
Jessica!
Well. Just 18 months old.
Jessica!
Just hours from death.
Problem here. You think it's possible for an 18-month-old child to fall down an 8-inch well?
No.
3309 Tanner Drive.
Word of Jessica McClure's flight travel.
While police and emergency personnel are doing all they can,
as a prayer circle forms to pray for the safety of little Jessica McClure, rescue efforts are intensifying. At this hour, a parallel rescue shaft is being drilled next to the water well she fell into.
Oh my God, nothing.
Temperature in the well's dropped down to 60 degrees.
We're looking at possible hypothermia. How long did you stay down?
If you can't raise the temperature, I'm afraid we don't have long at all.
We need a miracle is what we need.
Damn it. We're gonna get her out.
Is there anything I can tell the mother? She's terribly distraught.
It is 28 hours now that 18-month-old Jessica McClure has been entombed 22 feet below ground in an abandoned water well. Numerous rescue deadlines have been passed. It's no longer clear when they're going to reach the little girl.
Is she making any noise? Can you hear?
Sounds like she's choking. Move your head to the sides, sweetheart. Oh, God. Please don't let her choke. Not now.
Get hold of her. Can you get hold of her?
I don't think we're going to get her out of here, man.
I can't get her out!
Starring Patty Duke, Beau Bridges, Pat Hingle, and Roxana Zell. The Rescue of Jessica McClure.
Please don't let my baby die.
Michael has it all. He's a successful computer salesman with a beautiful home and family. But Michael makes a big mistake. Away from home, bored and lonely, he rings a telephone sex line.
Hello. My name's Carrie. What's yours?
But he rings the wrong sex line.
You sound like one bad, sexy woman.
I'm not a woman.
Oh, really? Oh, what would you call yourself?
A man.
Where am I calling?
The man line, Michael.
Man line? You mean... You sick bastard.
Carrie is hurt. He wants an apology, but it's gone too far.
I'm giving you a chance to redeem yourself. To apologize.
What do you want?
Michael, you're not listening. I want you to apologize.
You bastard, I want you to leave me alone. You understand? I don't owe you a thing.
We should talk.
God damn it! It's a joke, don't you understand? It's a joke!
Michael Henderson's office?
Miriam, I need to speak to Michael right away.
It's your wife. There's something wrong.
Yes, honey, what is it?
God. Oh, God, what happened? What happened? I want to know. What in the hell happened?
You hang on. I'll be right there.
Joe! What is it? What is it? What is it?
Oh, my God.
Yes.
Do you really wear these striped cotton pajamas to bed? It's not quite how I pictured you, Michael. Come on, Michael. Show me your stuff.
Michael Sarrazin in The Phone Call. A fatal attraction of a different kind.
Battle of Beaver Dams in 1813, one of the decisive battles of the War of 1812. And that happened on this date in 1813. Today in History is a regular feature of CQRR, the choice and voice of Grantham and the Niagara Peninsula. This is Billy Judd here with the eye opener. Judd pinch hits while Skeet sleeps in. Thanks a lot, Wally. It's a warm morning in Grantham. High today, let's see, a warm 23 degrees. The sun came up to 25 to 73. Dark early. Looking at the news at the top of the clock, we have two big items. The American Vice President has agreed to meet the Prime Minister in 2 weeks' time in Ottawa. And the spokesman for the Ultimate Church still refuses to say whether the disappearance of Norbert E. Patton, the founder and leader of the cult, has anything to do with an internal disintegration of the international religion. Patton has been missing for 3 weeks. Closer to home now, morning traffic on the QEW is snaking its way into the city or past it. Avoid the bottleneck at the Vineland Bridge, where a stalled tractor trailer is blocking the eastbound lane. Anyway, when I came into the studio this morning, I see a
get away from me.
Camper, mobile
home
down the road. Not even many American cars on the road. I'll tell you, the kids packed off the
road. Get out of here.
Head south, big send off. Luggage. you on the roof rack. Get out. Everything down our call is yet. No sign of frost out there, even up on the roof.
Summer was gone, vanished, up the flagpole. And Autumn crept into town and took it without firing a shot. Even the street characters were back from the cottage.
Morning, good luck.
I was puffing up Ontario Street to hear what my old school pal Ray Thornton had in the way of business for me.
Hi.
On the phone, Ray sounded like it was a big deal, so I put on clean socks just for the occasion. A private investigator has to watch the little things.
Oh, hey, buddy, how are you?
Norbert E. Patton.
So what?
Tonight, the blessed hand of Jesus is going to reach out and touch some of us sitting here.
More Norbert E. Patton, yeah, so?
So, Norbert E. Patton has disappeared.
Norbert E. Patton has disappeared, yeah.
Oh, look, don't repeat everything I say because we just don't have time, okay? We can do this at lunch.
We're going to have a little lunch, right?
We'll see. Maybe we will. Yeah. Look, from tent show revivalist
to
multi-million dollar TV evangelist, and he's gone through the keyhole. Now, I have a client who wants Patton found and watched. He's part of a multi-million dollar class action suit against Patton. So it's in his best interest to see to it that he doesn't escape the steely grip of the law.
Yeah, so?
So, a little bird tells me that Patton and friends crossed into Ontario through Port Huron a week ago. And they're holed up in a cabin in Algonquin Park. All we need is positive identification and a resident babysitter just to watch him until he makes his move.
Yeah, I'm not liking the sound.
Oh,
of this
boy, I don't believe you. I don't. You have not changed a bit.
I've changed a lot.
There are two things that are happening here. Now, the first one. Oh my. The first one is that Patton and the Ultimate Church are one legal entity, and Patton has all the church's resources with him. No, not two. The United States Supreme Court is about to come down with a ruling on the tax status of the church, and if they rule against Patton, then that means he can't go back in the United States.
So, Ray, I want to thank you for thinking of me, because I was probably the first.
Oh, no, look, you can go fishing. Think of all the fishing
fishing
catch waiting for him to show.
Ray, when I was 12 years old, I was in Algonquin Park. I had a sunstroke. I have had, Ray, dreams since that time about mosquitoes and those horrible things, the black flies that take little circles of flesh out of you.
Sure, okay, well, look,
horrible.
Think of this as
Ray,
you're
Ray,
getting a fat
feed. Nothing on earth is going to drag me to that infested hellhole.
Believe me.
Plain fact is, I wasn't made for the outdoor life. I'd failed when I was 12 at Camp Northern Pine. Now I was doing a repeat performance on Big Crummock Lake in Algonquin Park. My idea of untamed nature is a dandelion growing up through a crack in the sidewalk. Where the hell am I going to find a sidewalk up here?
Thank you.
And there he was, the high roller among the holy rollers, going fishing. Thornton told me he was using the name Norbert Edgar now. To me, it didn't seem an adequate disguise, but I didn't have the good Lord looking out for me the way Patton did.
Spence, I thought you checked that boat out.
I did, sir, but I don't
no,
know.
Now, I want no mistakes with the replacement. Now, get on it.
Yes, sir. Let's go to the hospital.
I'm fine. Well, that's one I owe you, fella. I don't forget the big ones. You delivered me from the waters. What's your name, fella?
Cooperman. Benny Cooperman.
My name's Norbert. Norbert Edgar. Edgar. I appreciate having my life back, fella. Thanks again.
From my brief acquaintance with him, I'd say that Patton was a perishable commodity. I took a good look at his boat. I carried my trophy catch lake trout back to my cabin at Petawawa Lodge. It would have been nice if there'd been a crowd on the dock to greet me, but everybody was battened down safe, dry, and out of sight. Oh, well, you lose some and you lose some.
Showers, Mr. Cooperman. I brought you milk.
Oh, terrific. Joan, why don't you just stick around for a little while and get dry? Maybe, if I'm lucky, I can get the kettle to boil.
Oh, no. I gotta fix the generator, otherwise we won't have any light tonight.
Oh.
Oh, I see you're new in these parts.
I'm
here. How'd you make out with the boat?
Oh, my boat was fine. But your neighbor, you know, Mr. Edgar?
Mm-hmm.
He almost blew up in here.
What? That was my boat.
Oh, really?
Well, I mean, he paid me for it.
Well, what'd you do, Joan? Sell him a damaged piece of goods?
Gee, you know, if that was an inboard, it could have been fumes from the bilge, but I never heard of an outboard exploding.
Are you saying you don't think it was an accident?
What a funny idea, Mr. Cooperman.
You know, it's just a game I play. If life is a mystery, who are the suspects? Call me Benny.
Okay, and you call me if you need anything.
No problem.
Like how to get the stove working.
All right.
Don't worry about the bats.
Bats?
Yeah, bats. They can really bother you at night if you're not used to them.
Where?
Joan Harbison had told me that if I wanted to meet my fellow campers, the place to go was the annex. The main lodge where the wet fisher folk assembled to dry off in front of the fireplace. If one of my fellow guests had it in for Norbert Patton, would he be the one reading Popular Mechanics?
Hi.
Welcome.
Benny.
Don't you look smart at all?
I'm a little wet.
Now, would you like coffee before you meet this gang?
No, I'm perfectly happy.
Well, let's just plunge right in then, shall
okay.
we? Everybody? I hate to break up this little party. Hello. This is our new guest, Mr. Cooperman.
Hi.
Mr. Cooperman, this is Sissy Piercy.
Benny.
How do you do?
Hi.
Pass.
This is her better half, Lloyd, over here by the Victrola. And this is David Kipp, our foremost bird watcher.
It's a bad time, Joan. Six spades.
This is Maggie McCord and her son, George. They live down the road a piece.
You bid six spades?
Hi there.
Double.
I'll pass. Just arrived, Mr. Cooperman.
Yeah, I just finished unpacking, but call me Benny.
Maggie and George are more like family to me than neighbors.
Well, I hope you can play bridge, Mr. Cooperman. We could use an infusion of new blood.
That's transfusion, isn't it?
Joan, when are you going to stock some beer? I swear I'm dying of thirst.
George, as it says in my brochure, until such time as I am able to obtain a liquor license, I will be happy to uncork your wine.
Oh,
I've run this place for years. Do you think I can get a liquor license? No.
Who is that couple over by the fire?
Ah, that is Dean Alexander and Des Westmoreland. They just met up here, but I think they're making up for lost time.
Hey.
Now, who haven't we met? Yes. Ah.
I have my circuits are loaded over here.
Well, Mr. Cooperman, if you're going to be a real fisherman, you've got to get on the right side of the fishing guide.
The fishing guide.
That doesn't make any sense, Anais.
Anais DeFond, Lloyd Piercy, Mr. Cooperman.
Benny,
hi. You arrived just in time this afternoon for the big storm. Did you two get caught in it?
Yeah, we're up in Little Crummock.
We got soaked pretty good, too. Benny?
Yeah, Benny, hi.
Oh, I saw you in that tin fish of yours this morning.
Tin fish? He means that aluminum sardine can you rented.
My boat, Lloyd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You up for the whole week?
Yeah.
That was just Josh and Aeneas. I hear about the storm.
Yeah. That lake trout like to stay in the shallow water between the islands. But you fish the shadows.
Shadows.
Hey, George. You'll be interested in this. Aeneas and I got caught off a Little Crummock in the rain. He swears he heard thunder before he saw the lightning.
Another one of your superstitions, Aeneas? Like fishing the night of the new moon? I said what I heard. I know, sounds funny. Maybe not so funny. I go and look. If I find nothing, then you laugh.
Yeah? Well, I'm laughing now. Check the weather. If you see your shadow, in for an early winter?
You make jokes, George, but your eyes stay different.
Joan, you're gonna lose that road if you don't do something about those beavers.
Beavers are not the problem.
I know, Lloyd, I know. The beavers have blocked and dammed the culvert under the road about a mile from here.
I saw that as I came
I'm afraid of a washout.
I've seen a 20-foot section of good road washed out. I mean, this is just sand and gravel.
Well, don't scare her, Lloyd. Aeneas won't see her stranded, will you?
Oh, I'm camped near there. I'll take care of it.
She's only talking for her own good.
You usually are, Lloyd.
Well, another country heard from.
George, I think it's time we went home, huh?
Oh. Hey, watch it, George.
Come, George.
Ah.
To the hymn had been learned in spite of myself back in public school. Now they came bubbling to the surface and coming out of my mouth. Once I get started, I guess I can sing half the hymn book. If spelling had been forbidden fruit, I might have ended up an educated man.
Now, Mr. Cooperman.
Benny.
Oh, Benny. Okay. Benny, you have a rare voice indeed.
No, it's just an old shower barrel.
Oh, Benny, you're too honest. You have a very pure sound.
I do.
It's
George thinks our singing's sentimental, but we all like it. Good exercise for the lungs. We don't have to talk about the spirit, do we?
What's the puddle?
That's a nice bit of crumpet for somebody.
Nice if you got your pockets full of money. The car she drives?
No.
Corvette.
Name's Aileen Barber. Arrived today.
Has she ever been to the lodge before?
Long time ago.
Not to my knowledge. Oh, you mean my knowing her name? Well, let me tell you, there's not much goes on around here that I don't know about. I know, for instance, that you saved Mr. Edgar's life this afternoon up at the lake.
What? He what?
I'll tell you all about it sometime. Well, I'll say goodnight. Goodnight, Sissy. I said goodnight, Sissy.
Oh, goodnight, Maggie.
Good night, Maggie. Pleasant dreams.
Good night, Mrs. McCord.
Call me Maggie. Everybody does, remember?
Good night, Delia.
Good night, Dad.
Sleep well.
You too.
Good night, Aeneas. Oh, Benny! Come over to tea tomorrow, if you like. Good night.
Good night, Maggie. Nice people.
Good night, Mr. Kemp.
But I had a funny feeling at the back of my knees that there was more going on here at the lodge than a nightly game of bridge. The thought that it might have something to do with Mr. Edgar up the lake put a taste of bile in my chopped liver.
I'm sorry, I probably almost hit you with the hook. Right.
So you're Cooperman.
Cooperman, yeah, that's me. You're,
Aileen Barber.
Aileen Barber? Why is that name familiar to me?
I'm a theatrical designer.
I'm, doing some very serious, fishing here. Got a great cloud cover. It's a great day for it. As soon as I can untie the boat now. Like egg salad?
Hello there, fella.
My God. You should put a horn on that thing. You almost gave me a heart attack. Where'd you learn that?
Little trick I learned from Aeneas Dufon when we were kids. Say, now, you're not fishing.
No, I'm giving the fish a break. They're exhausted.
I've been looking over the wreckage of my boat there.
What'd you find?
Just a couple of loose wires.
You know, Mr. Edgar, I think somebody's trying to harm you.
Now, why do you think someone would want to harm me?
No, I don't know. You're probably right, actually. It's just that maybe somebody's got a grudge against you. You knew Aeneas Dufault. You probably know everybody on the lake.
Everybody? Most of the places are shut up for the season now. There's just the folks at the lodge there. There's me and my people, and there's you, fella.
Well, maybe it was an accident. Maybe it's just, it's probably just, you know, fuel in the bilges. But if it's not, they may try again. I hope you're not planning to stay here for too long.
I'm just planning to stay long enough to get a message and a package here, and then I might finish my holidays in a real boat in the Mediterranean.
Mm. Nice.
No, that's Nice. You know, there's something I'd like to know about you, Mr. Cooperman. Do you happen to be a good chess player? Damn it, Cooperman, back off.
I said garde loud and clear.
Well, that's the second straight, damn it.
Relax, come on, the game isn't over. Your king has got plenty of kick left. Mm-hmm. Just, what line are you in back in civilization, Mr. Edgar? Mate.
Now, what kind of a game is there? Now, that's book learned chess. That's not rough and tumble. Now, what do you call it, Benny? Is that the Schmata defense? Is that the Hebrew gambit, huh?
I'd hit him with the Scotch gambit, but I didn't tell him. It would only open up the territory to wider and deeper national slurs. Funny, he never got racial when he was winning.
Now then, what line am I in? Well, I need some writing on these things.
Religion, eh? If you're saying that God loves to forgive sinners, well, that's okay with us sinners. Where would we both be without the other?
Now, where did you read your theology, fella?
Hotel rooms. If you grow up in a place like Grantham, you end up Protestant, whether you like it or not. The synagogue is located at the corner of Calvin and Church. Mate.
Lorca, this drink's like soup. But can't you find me some ice? Honey? Lust not after her beauty, fella. She's mine.
You know, those sunglasses should be outlawed by the international rules of chess.
Anyhow, you're afraid of sex. I can see that. I weep for you and I pray for you. And now, sinner, I'm gonna beat your pants off.
Okay, so our friend is waiting for a passport.
Yeah, listen. In the meantime, somebody has tried to kill him.
What?
Ah, you listening to me now? Okay, yeah, somebody tried to blow up his boat, and yours truly saved his life. Now I'm practically one of the family.
Benny, I want him alive.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Hold on. Listen, you don't have something against the New Testament that I don't know about, do you?
Why are you always dramatizing? Why can you not have a day like everybody else? You know, you wake up, you go to work, you come home, you go to bed. What is wrong with that, Benny?
I can't make a living that way, Ray.
Sleep tight, Benny.
It's easy for you to say. Hi.
Hi.
You all by yourself?
Yeah, the boys are off getting the heavy stuff.
Oh, yeah? Mind if I,
feel free? Have you got a cigarette?
No problem.
Thanks.
Okay.
Nori doesn't like it, so I have to watch myself.
Wow.
You won't give me away, will you?
Come on, for smoking a cigarette, what are you, crazy? I hear he frowns on drinking, too.
Yeah, sure. Look not upon the wine when it is red.
Oh, wait, I know this one. For in the end, it something, stingeth. It stingeth like something stupid.
The adder. You're funny.
Oh, yeah, give me one of those too, okay?
Cream and sugar?
The works, live it up. Wait, what is it, tea or coffee?
It's hard to tell.
Yeah.
Lorca.
Excuse me.
No, your name, Lorca. That's a Spanish writer, right?
Bingo. My parents' idea, they were very committed in the 60s. Uh-huh. My sister's name is Ninel.
Well?
Ninel. It's Lenin spelled backwards.
That's heavy. That's very heavy.
Boy, it is beautiful in the country, isn't it?
You know something? I hate it here, okay? I hate it here.
Just between you and me, the quicker we get out of here, the better.
I know, I'm all burned and everything.
I am not an outdoorsy slash woodsy kind of person. I mean, I love Nuri and all that, but I got these few weaknesses of the flesh that he's not so crazy about, like drinking and smoking. Thanks.
Okay. But he smokes cheroots, though, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah. Lives for them. That's because he's special.
I think it's a little bit unfair around the edges, if you ask me.
Well, you get used to it. It's just his way. That's Nuri. He's not like anybody else.
Yeah. Well, you guys keep pretty much to yourselves, so
cream
I was curious.
And sugar. Pan your way out.
Yeah. You guys keep to yourselves.
So? You stayed up in one of the cabins? Most of them are empty right now.
No, we're canoeing to Winnipeg. I was saying you keep to yourselves up here, right? Mm. You and Mutt and Jeff and Mr. Edgar. Now, George comes once in a while with a catch of fish, right? You're like hermits up there.
Did you say that you were in ladies ready to wear, Mr. Cooperman?
Yeah. Don't call me Mr. Cooperman. Benny, call me Benny, okay?
Yeah, I'll try it on. Thanks for the coffee.
Yeah.
See ya.
Yeah, no. Okay, Cooperman. So much for the subtle touch. Time you went home.
Hi there.
Hi. Have you found what the trouble is?
Oh. Welcome to Hoover Dam, Mr. Cooperman. Those beavers, they can build a dam faster than I can rip it apart.
Well, just a second here. And I'll...
No, you'll get your trousers all wet.
I don't worry about a thing. Cooperman to the rescue. Just relax. Okay.
I'd roll him up higher than that.
Yeah, no, I'm just gonna do the shallow part here. Get rid of some of the debris.
Oh, okay. I got two of these down here. Uh-huh. I want to lay them up against the culvert intake there. I can slow the little beggars down a bit.
Yeah.
Careful. Oh, okay, I got something here. Benny.
What's a private investigator doing at Petawawa Lodge, Mr. Is it Cooperman?
It's Cooperman, yes. I'm doing the same as Mr. Kip and Mr. Piercy. I am getting a little suntan, catching some fish.
I'm taking a note. You haven't been here before the way Piercy and Kip have. This is your first week here, and look what happens.
Look, I think you're working under a pretty broad assumption. Is it Corporal? Corporal? I don't think you have a shred of evidence that there's anything sinister in me being here, okay?
That's right. I just like to see the way it rubs you. Right now, I don't care a pinch why you're here, but when I do, and I will, I want answers, not citified malarkey.
Okay, fine. I only met the dead man once, okay? Last night at the annex. I have no idea how he got into the culvert.
What do you think happened?
What do I think? I think that even an Indian guide can lose his footing and get tugged under. Maybe the current got him. Maybe he was cleaning out the culvert the same way that me and Miss Harbison were.
Maybe that's a peck of maybes. First of all, Aeneas wouldn't go in there and fix the culvert with his good clothes on. Second, there's a bash at the back of his head that suggests to me he didn't get wet as his own idea. I'm no doctor, but till I see a medical report, I'm looking for a murderer. That's what makes me curious about what a body like you'd be doing up here. Is there something going on, Mr. Cooperman? Something I'm gonna find out about?
Look, Corporal, I only just arrived at the lodge. I have collected a burn on my neck. I've got a peeling nose. I've got dishpan hands. Yesterday, I caught a lake trout a yard long. Nobody saw me bring it in. We've all got troubles. And I have not the glimmering of an idea why anybody would want to kill Aeneas Defoe.
I would like you to stay well out of my way, Mr. Cooperman. You understand?
Yes. Well, I always like to cooperate with the authorities.
Bull roar. You keep your ass clear of this. We don't want private cops messing around here, getting lost in the bush, stuck in the swamp, or drowning themselves. You got all that?
Yes, you make yourself exceptionally clear, Corporal. Now, can I go? My ice cream is melting. Knowing nothing about the etiquette of the North Woods, when I called on Maggie McCord about an hour later, it was at least partly to find out whether sudden death automatically cancels a previous invitation to tea.
You never married, Benny?
Never married. My mother would like it too much.
I can see that you've recovered from your dreadful discovery this morning, Benny.
Oh, boy.
Two lumps, wasn't it?
It was, but I would like three. I do have a sweet tooth.
Oh, so do I. How about four?
Four is better.
Oh, dear me. Poor Aeneas never caused such a fuss when he was alive.
What do you think happened?
Oh, we'll never know. You know, Betty, people like to make a plot to explain why an expert canoeist and woodsman would drown in a lake that he knew as well as I know the recipe for this chocolate cake. I can see you eyeing it. Would you like another piece?
Yes. And what kind of man was he?
Aeneas Dufour?
Mm.
Albert, that's my dear late husband, Albert. He used to say that there wasn't another guide like him in the park. Mm. I don't want to indulge in cliches about Indians, Benny, but he was a natural man. I don't believe he had an enemy in the world. It's a dreadful shame.
Now, this was your husband in these photographs here, Maggie?
Oh, Albert was another born woodsman. Never needed a compass nor matches.
Ma, are you here?
I have a visitor, George. Come in and say hello to Mr. Cooperman. He has a voice just like your father's.
Well, I have to go over and see.
Yeah, hi there.
Hi.
Harry Glover. He's talking to Sissy Percy now, and he wants to see me next. How do, Mr. Cooperman? Fishing going good?
How do, Georgia? Thanks for asking. Yes, it's nice. It's in the shade, you know. You need quiet water.
Ma, I
gotta... Possess your soul in patience, George.
Now, Maggie, I can go if it would be more convenient.
Hold your ground, Benny. George knows how to twiddle his thumbs. Now, this moose...
These oils are by a local artist, Maggie?
Dick Berners, yes. He used to love to paint the woods in the fall.
Beautiful colors.
Look thy last on all things lovely every hour.
Well, that's... Old Dick, an artist?
Mind your tongue, George. He was a great friend of George's father, my Albert.
Oh, yeah, old Dick, he was quite the character. Oh, yeah, you could smell him coming through the bush. Always covered in soot from his campfires. You wouldn't want to get near him.
Well, let's shut up about poor Dick Berners.
Boy, that looks like a witch's Sabbath, doesn't it, George?
Well, that's the inside of the old mill that burned down. I recognize those beams. Ma.
Hush, George. George has to talk to Harry Glover, the policeman from Hatchway that spoke to you.
Oh, right. Maggie, I'm terribly sorry, but I really have to run. Thanks a lot for the tea. And George, it's always a pleasure to see you.
And now you know the way. Don't be a stranger.
I won't.
Say goodbye, George.
Yeah, see you at the lodge.
Take care.
Oh, gonna be a nice night, eh?
Uh-huh.
Yep. Oh,
guess the hardest thing a police officer has to do is break bad news, eh? I guess it never gets any easier when you come to think about it. Where are your reinforcements?
Last time I came out here was last spring when we brought out old Dick Burners.
Old Dick Burners?
Yep. Checked himself out of the hospital, went back in the bush, and died in his little cabin. Huh. Cancer. That'll be Lloyd Piercy, I guess. Lloyd knew Aeneas pretty good. They did a lot of fishing together. Yes, sir. A lot of fishing. A lot of years.
I've been to the police museum in Toronto. Black Museum. Weapons from famous murders.
Yes?
Trouble is, a bread knife looks like any other bread knife, even if it's murdered dozens.
That sounds very brave. I wonder if you dare to spend the night there.
I don't believe in ghosts, if that's what you mean, Maggie.
These new rationalists. I'm sure the angels weep for you.
Well, if any place has ghosts, it must be this place. The police laid Dick Burner's body here overnight when he was found dead in his cabin. They laid him right out there on the ping pong table.
Joe, you remember the frozen loggers?
Oh, God. A couple of guys got killed on the log boom up in the lake. They brought him in.
Smashed heads by logs.
In there, over there, and stood him up against the wall, and they stood there frozen
solid up against the wall. Frozen but when popsicles. I come down in the morning, maybe melted away or something. Rigor mortis.
This is disgusting! That man was right there last night. Where are you people?
Maggie, is it Dick Burners, the painter, that you're all talking about?
Dick Burners. He was a mad one. Always claimed he was prospecting here for gold.
Wait a minute. What's the joke?
There isn't any gold in Algonquin Park.
Yeah, and it's illegal to mine here, so even if he'd found the bonanza of all time, he wouldn't have been allowed to work it.
It's a provincial park, you see.
My Albert thought the world of Dick Burness. He was a good man, better than any of you will ever know.
He had a shack up on Little Cromock Lake, didn't he, Maggie? Oh.
Okay, it's just a generator. I'll come back in a minute, I think. Please. Oh, yeah. Good. There we go.
You know what I think? I think it's time for a sing-song.
Maggie, I think it is. Oh, Maggie, maybe you can wake up old Dick Burner. Nice night for a paddle.
Oh, it's you. You startled me. You shouldn't sneak up on people like that. All by yourself? It's cooler tonight. You've got a burn on your nose.
Is this the first time you're up here?
Uh-huh. stars. Every one of them is a sun with whirling planets. Do you think they know as little about us as we know about them?
I beg your pardon? I'd like to know a little bit more about you. Where do you go in that canoe of yours?
Into the universe. Up into the stars.
You must get good mileage on the canoe. And which of the galaxies around here do you visit?
I believe in the presence of evil. Good is only the temporary absence of evil. I believe there are evil presences in this universe. I'm Manichaean. And you?
I'm conservative, tending to reform.
Are there networks of information up there we know nothing about? What do you think, Mr. Cooperman?
Well, I'm no expert, but I like to concentrate on people, you know, when I can.
The stars are the only absolutes.
Meg. Mm-hmm. I need some orange juice. Now, where's that woman? She knows I need orange juice.
Come on, let's play another one. One more.
Now, when you're licked, fella, why don't you just stay licked? Anyhow, you take an hour to make your moves every time.
I'm sorry.
Just...
Ow! Ow! What happened?
Cut my finger out.
Give it to me.
What?
Come here. Come here. Run this underwater. What did you do? Where did you do that?
I don't know. In the bag, a box there, something. I don't know.
Down here in this box. Where'd you cut your... Vomit.
Mark, what for? Just a shock, that's all.
You suck your finger, vomit. If you don't do what I say, you could be dead in 10 minutes. Look at this. Wretch, wretch there, wretch.
Wretch!
Stick your finger in your mouth. Not that one. This one. All right. Wash the inside of your cheek out carefully.
All right.
Wrench, wrench, wrench.
I'm trying.
Wrench.
And
skip the car guy.
He's had an accident. Take him to the nearest hospital. Come on, run, 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 go.
I'm moving as fast as I can.
Come here. Take this. Show it to the doctor. Don't cut yourself. I think you'll die. Mr. Patton has been poisoned.
I won't forget this, fella.
Go, go. Bancroft is the closest place. Go!
It was one of those moments you wish you could replay and improve on the second time around. I'd called him Patton. I'd called him by his real name.
Listen, there is a murder investigation going on at the lodge.
Murder?
Right?
Anything touching our friend?
Well, I don't know. It's local. Somebody killed a fishing guide.
Big deal.
No, maybe it's connected. You see, the dead guy knew our party from years ago. Wait a minute. I thought you told me he was born in West Virginia.
He rewrote his biography. He was born in Huntsville, not far from the park.
And there is a woman here, Ray, named Aileen Barber, who keeps an eye on our party whenever I go off duty.
Benny, I want you to stay up there for a little while longer.
Listen, you don't happen to have two people working on this assignment, do you, you miserable piece of crud?
If I wanted a real A-team, I would have hired a real detective agency.
God, stay up!
You come back here again, I'll kill you.
You won't take on so high and mighty when people find out!
We're out here!
You just wait till people know! I just came to talk!
I suppose George could have been trying to borrow a cup of sugar, but to me it looked like it had something to do with the clipping he showed Delia. What does Westmoreland have to hide? How is it connected with Aeneas's death, or the attempts on Patton's life? At least Patton was safe in hospital. That'll give me time to explore Dick Berner's shack in the woods. when the weather clears. If the weather clears.
If you're going into Little Crummer...
Are
you going in through the York River and Four Corners Lake?
I'm not...
That's Buck Lake on the map. But Buck? He's going up the Buck Derwent Lake. River and...
I am?
Here. Yeah, through Deer Lake.
Uh-huh.
That's Bice Lake on your map.
Bice Lake on my map?
Mr. Cooperman.
Take
the compass.
Why do I need a compass?
That's a pretty rough map, Lloyd. We don't want you getting lost.
You'll get him there and it'll bring him back. I don't know about the wind, though. You've never been in a big blow before.
No. What I'm curious about is old Dick Berner's cabin. You know, that's on the north shore of whatever lake this is?
It always has been.
Yeah?
Right at the entrance to Percy Lake.
It's at the entrance to Percy?
Which is Pine Lake on your map.
That's Pine Lake on my map. Okay.
Don't shoot the rapids on the Derwent River.
Rapids? Look, I've got that marked as a Tom River on this map. If you stick close to the north channel going into the portage, you'll miss the whitewater.
Yeah, see, what I'd like to do
is not do this stuff at all. Until after the second
I'd like to think about it for another week.
You all gassed up, Cooperman?
No. Yes, I'm gassed, but the weather is a little dark.
You'll be very comfortable in this.
Yeah, no.
Do you people eat sardines, Mr. Cooperman?
Here's some cookies to eat on the trail, and here's some dried fruit just in case you feel...
What I was thinking was...
Here we go. You ready? Give me a hand in the book.
Yeah, thank you.
Whoa. Okay, now, Mr. Cooperman.
Yeah.
This was given to me by somebody very special once, so you take care of it, come back. Yeah. Well, you sure got a good day for it.
So long, great. Cooperman. Oh, damn. Hey, Mr. Cooperman, you'll have to come back. You forgot my map.
He forgot his own map, too.
Isn't this your fishing equipment, Mr. Cooperman?
I'll never know how many blocks I walked. I pictured myself dropping dead along the trail, or getting rescued by Corporal Glover and his I told you so. Maybe I wouldn't die from exposure. Maybe I'd just be reduced to a vegetable. What kind of vegetable would I like to be reduced to? Cucumber? Squash?
Okay, I give up. That's it. Joan, this is really useful.
Yeah.
Look thy last on all things lovely every hour.
There was something out there, and the dust in the cabin had recently been disturbed. My feet wanted to hit the homeward trail. I kept feeling the bush closing in on me. What I needed to do was relax with a good department store catalog to get my priorities unscrambled. Only a one-holer, and the plumbing's out of order. This might be the last outhouse for miles. The chill of the water took away my headache, but the pain in my ears got me until I remembered the knife. I opened it with my teeth and nearly slashed my leg off as I hacked away at the weighted rope. My head felt like I'd been hatching flies in it. I remember cutting the rope, but not who drove me home. If I was capable of thought, it went something like this. How come an old broken-down outhouse is off limits? It didn't figure. I always suspected that Dick Berners was a very canny customer, pretending to be a hard luck prospector and all the time But it wasn't Berners who tried to bash my skull in. There is another serious miner around here, and I already know he doesn't like company. Clipping from a Toronto paper, a nice picture of Des Westmoreland from the lodge. The woman with him was Rosalind Pike, the cabinet minister. So Des Westmoreland wasn't Des Westmoreland. He was Desmond Brewer and married to the cabinet minister. Well, George, that's why you were bothering Des and Delia. Nobody likes a blackmailer. You should have stuck to running donuts around me in the water. If I sat down and wept, it wasn't because I was beside the waters of Babylon. No. The creek I was up had a different name, one that even Lloyd hadn't thought of. The pine gum gave me a clue. The idea came from all those Saturday matinees at the Granada Theater in Grantham when I was a kid. Now tell me I was wasting my time.
Mr. Cooperman! Mr. Cooperman!
Huh? Thank God! Can you give me a hand?
What are you doing out there?
Could we have this discussion just a little later, please?
Where have you been?
I'm drowning over here, okay?
Do you have a painter on board?
I'm sinking and you're talking about redecorating?
It's that rope up at the front there. Throw it to me when I get close enough. Here I come now.
This is a painter?
That's a painter.
What are you doing? Aren't you sick in the hospital?
No, I'm right here. I checked myself out. That thing wasn't poisoned.
Not even a little bit?
No. Now shut off your engine. Now you better get over here. That thing isn't seaworthy.
No. Okay.
Come on now.
Okay.
Now, Mr. Cooperman, you look like you have been smitten by the Almighty.
Yeah, I know.
And now my enemy is delivered into my hands.
Who are you working for?
I'm not working for anybody. I'm here on a holiday.
You're not being straight with me.
I saved your neck twice, didn't I?
Why do you smell like disinfectant?
Come on, it's pine gum. I used it to patch my boat. I saw it once in a movie.
Lorca, I'm talking.
Mr. Patton, what do I have to do to prove to you I'm not an enemy?
I don't trust anybody. You're all out for yourselves. And you have known who I was right from the start.
Yeah, your picture's plastered all over Time magazine.
That's right. I am Norbert E. Patton. That is my going out and my coming in, my beginning and my end. I have to know what's going on.
Nori.
And I looked around me, and I was friendless. And daggers grew behind every smile.
Oh, my God, Nori, if it's that dangerous, let's just go. Let's go home.
Lorca, shut up.
Nori, you're a bastard, you know that? There isn't anything to do here. You won't even talk to me. You didn't tell me it was gonna be like this. Hey, how would you like a roll in the hay, Mr. Cooperman? For medicinal purposes, of course. I saw it in a movie. Nori, you don't ever do that to me. You hear? Not ever again. I owe you plenty, but I'm not being slapped around. You don't touch me again.
I'll pitch you woman out of my house and bolt the door!
Nori, something's come up.
Spence will drive you back to the lodge.
Oh, terrific. Well, thanks for the rescue. I'll return your clothes later, okay?
Don't give it a second thought, fella.
Thanks. Just...
Did it come?
No.
Damn.
Listen, I saw that woman when I drove past the lodge. It's her all right.
She see you?
No.
She knows I'm here. Damn, that woman pursues me like an unclean spirit. Well, get out of here. Leave me alone. I got to think now.
Okay, got the shoes. Everything's okay. I left a blanket here. Pick it up later. Thanks for all your help. You're a terrific guy. No.
All right. Is it worth interrupting your dinner now? Now, I'll go over the whole thing again if it'll help.
I got the rough outline. You know, the gold mine, the bump on the head,
yes.
Near drowning, and yeah. George McCord dead on Little Crummock Lake.
That's it.
Did you tell anyone else?
I just finished telling you. I came right over here.
Did you tell anyone else?
No, I didn't.
Let's just keep you. It that way.
All right.
You got the stomach to tell Maggie?
No.
Hail to thee, blithe spirit. Here you are. Sweets to the sweet. Oh, you are a thing of beauty and a joy forever. Don't you just know it? Don't be greedy. I promised you dinner, didn't I? Promises. One grows old on promises. Annie. Have you come to help me feed this thankless slut?
Evening, everybody. Hi, Lloyd.
I hope you can tell us what this latest murder's all about. I can't get anybody to open up. How long are they going to keep us here?
Search me.
Poor Joan. All the effort you put into this place. Now two murders. She might as well hang up her shutters for good.
How generous to be worried about the lodge. What about us? Who's going to be next? Have you thought about that?
Women.
How is she?
Oh, she's sleeping like a baby. I held her and rocked her back.
Hey, dear boy.
You're a good friend, Sissy. Mr. Cooperman. Didn't expect to see you here tonight.
Well, I've never seen a body so broke up about anything. You had to waste it on George.
Thanks for the knife.
Hey, you're welcome.
Nobody liked George.
Lloyd, are you just going to hold the ball or are you going to give us a drink?
George had his points. He was like a half-tame bear most of the time.
first she got morbid.
She always looked after him. Whether it was a little poaching, a little illegal fishing, yeah. He was always in a jam. It was only half the man his father was.
First she got morbid, then maudlin.
Mr. Cooperman.
No, I won't, thanks.
Talking about her ruined life, how nobody understood her.
That's not the cooking, Sherry, sissy. You're gonna make yourself sick.
Oh, duff whack.
We're running short. I've got another bottle in the cabin.
Oh, this isn't a dead soldier yet. Oh, don't give him any.
I'd just like to know if it's safe to go back to my cabin tonight.
You know you can't drink.
George was a son of a bitch. Whoever killed him did everybody a favor. We haven't had a night like this since the old mill burnt down.
All right, that's it, sissy. I'm taking you home.
My big mouth.
Whoa, careful.
Sometimes I think I'm a little juvenile delinquent.
Bye, sissy.
You know that, Vinny?
Lloyd, do you remember the fire at the mill?
Oh, jeez. That's a night to remember. 15 years ago, if it was a day.
What happened?
The sissy and me were camped about a mile from here, across the lake.
Yeah?
We just finished supper when we saw it. So we came across as fast as we could. In a canoe. The fire was burning like a bat out of hell. But there was no saving the mill.
And what about the lodge guests?
They were all gone when we got here.
Oh, that's a load!
Up and over, that's the way to do it. You know, this place couldn't keep a guest even in the high season. Uh-huh. There were some city people here. Three of them, but they were gone.
Eyewash, duff whack. There was not you, old liar. You
I think I can handle her from here on in, Mr. Cooperman.
Oh, okay.
Good night.
Bye,
good night.
Daddy!
In spite of my recent adventures, I was up early the next morning. The bats and I spell each other off that way. The lodge was quiet, not a loon stirring. At least it felt like that. I'm no authority on early. The ruins of the old mill lay down by the lake, giving modest shelter to Joan's precious generator. There was nothing pokey about the mill's proportions. In its day, it must have dominated the lake, back in the old lumbering days. An impressive picture it must have made the night it burned down. But how is what happened 15 years ago going to help me now?
Talking out of school about my little adventures.
I hear that you were rescued by the reclusive Mr. Edgar up the lake. He's quite a man of mystery, isn't he? What's he like?
You know what I think? I think you know the answer to that better than I do, Miss Barber.
What do you mean?
Well, you've been watching him more than I have. I think we'd be a lot further ahead if we just trusted each other. That's what I mean.
You aren't the font of tact, are you?
Yeah, I think tact's a waste of time, especially since he's planning on pulling out.
Wayne, how do you know that? You first.
All right. He's not going to leave till the end of the week because he wants to get something. He's not going to take off till he gets his hot little hands on it.
On what? You're a very strange man.
I'm a strange man. Why?
You keep everything so tightly controlled. It's like you've taken an oath or something. Are you always this serious?
Your turn. How long have you known Patton?
promised salvation. And he ended up by being a crook. I was just one of the ones he swindled.
Oh, I see. You're just one of those poor, broke souls that are taking him to court, eh, Miss Barber?
I know who you're working for. And I could have you pulled out this case like that if I thought we were working at cross purposes.
Oh, Miss Barber, we may just be working at cross purposes. If I were you, I'd have me taking off this case fast as you possibly can.
Morning!
Mr. Cooperman. What have you been up to? You know what I think? I think you've been watching her.
Well, who wouldn't?
Well, don't be too smug. 'Cause I've been watching you. I didn't think we'd finished our conversation.
I'm sorry. I have gone back to bed.
I'll make coffee.
There's a couple of questions I would like to ask you.
I'm 34. Married, but with an independent income. I like fast cars, chilled Chablis, clothes of the 50s. I'm a Libra. I have a low boiling point. I love to scrap. But I prefer to make up.
And you've known Patton for how long?
You said Patton's not leaving until he got his hot little hands on what? On what?
A passport. He's waiting for a new passport. If the tax thing doesn't work out, then he'll have a new identity.
As dear old Mae West once said, is that a pistol in your pocket, or are you just happy to see me?
The kettle's boiling. It's definitely boiling. You said this is your first time up here? Aileen? Aeneas recognized you. Long time ago?
15 years ago. We were staying at the mill. I was 20. I was living with a man named John Millbeck. He was my teacher and my lover.
There were three of you, though. Weren't there three of you, Aileen?
Yes. Three. The third was Norrie Patton.
You and Patton and Malbec. And what happened at the mill, Aileen? What is that round stone?
There is a ritual known as the Book of Babylon.
Yes.
We acted out the impregnation of the Scarlet Woman. It's all in the Book of Revelation. The purpose of the rite was to spawn the evil one on my body.
Oh,
didn't see it. It was gone when I looked. But at the window they saw. They swear they saw the devil himself. The face of the evil one.
What about John Malbec? What happened to him?
That night I became Norrie's woman. He kept me for 5 years. Later I found out that Norrie cheated John of all his savings. John killed himself in a rented room. Norrie, he said, is what John saw at the mill that broke him, but I know it was Norrie that broke him. Norrie and me.
You're telling me that Norbert E. Patton, the well-known TV evangelist, was a Satanist 15 years ago? Who knows about it?
Malbec's dead. Now only Norrie and I know. And you.
No wonder he's not in a big rush to see you again.
Mr. Cooperman. Here's your Toronto
Thanks.
Paper, and this is your milk. And
great.
I have to go, because
yep.
Boiler's on the blink.
Patton won't need that new identity after all.
Moving day, huh?
May the Lord be with you.
Hi, guys.
Yeah, honey.
Thank you, darling.
Hi.
I thought we were through with social calls.
I am just returning these clothes and,
this tax thing, that's terrific. Congratulations.
Yes, the hand of the Almighty has delivered us.
How you doing, Lorca?
We're going home. Isn't it wonderful?
Yeah.
If you're here to confess your sins, I'm ready to listen. Now, but I'm leaving in an hour, so you don't have much time.
Oh, listen. You know that boat thing that exploded? I found out it was some crazy woman. Well, you probably know her. Aileen Barber?
Woman?
I don't think that's any of your business, fella.
What woman?
I'd leave that alone, in fact, if
I were you. Well, it's been a rotten summer altogether. First, Phineas Dufault, then George McCord.
Those poor bastards.
Now, they're with the Lord now, Lorca. Now, mind your mouth.
It was sad for you anyway, because those guys were friends of yours a long time ago, right?
Norrie's got nothing to do with those murders. Can you imagine him taking an axe and sticking it in someone's head? I mean, it's crazy.
I think you better go now, fella. Wilf, Spence, get up here and escort this mammon of unrighteousness off the property.
Oh, my God.
Aileen.
Say your prayers, Norrie.
The Lord has brought you back to me.
Aileen.
I want you to put down that instrument of the devil.
John Malbec trusted you. I trusted you.
And I want you to trust me again. Remember now, you are my angel.
Put your hands together, Norrie. Pray.
I'm praying for you now.
Our Father.
Who
art in heaven?
In heaven.
Hallowed be thy name.
Don't
thy kingdom come.
Praise the Lord.
Six quick tricks. Mr. Cooperman, now what's all this about? I mean,
oh, I don't think you people want to hear any of my secrets.
Why? What are you going to do? Take them to your grave?
No. I think you people are the ones with secrets.
Secrets are dangerous to carry around, Cooper.
Yeah, and you would know more about that than most of us, wouldn't you, Lloyd?
Who, me?
Yeah, you're the one who was with Aeneas when he heard the thunder.
Superstitions.
Oh, I don't think so. It wasn't even thunder, and you know it. It was blasting.
Blasting?
Yeah, blasting. You know the other day when I was up at Little Crummock, Dick Berner's place, you know what I found up there?
a gold mine and blasting powder. Dick Berners used to work that mine. You know how he kept his secret? He used to pretend to be an out-of-work prospector. That way, nobody would know when he hit pay dirt.
Are you going too fast for me?
I think I'm going too fast. Not for Lloyd.
It was none of my business, and it's none of yours.
Well, it's a little too late for that now, isn't it? Before Dick Berners was laid out dead on that ping-pong table, he passed the secret of the mine on to somebody else. No, Lloyd is just nosy, no. But it was this other person that Aeneas heard blasting and that hit me on the back of the head and that I found dead up on Little Crummock Lake.
George! Liar. Cut his tongue out.
Maggie.
George didn't do it. He couldn't do it. George didn't kill Aeneas.
Nobody said George killed anybody. It's just that Aeneas was about to stumble on the secret of the mine. Aeneas had to be stopped and... Well, murder stopped Aeneas.
Maggie!
Oh, Benny, how could you?
Do you have some water?
Oh. Benny, you here?
Hi. I'll be with you in a sec, okay?
Looks like Patton's gonna live.
When can I see him?
What do you want to see him for? He's in a filthy temper. Tried to buy the hospital so he could fire his nurse.
And what about Aileen?
Her husband went bail for her, so she's free.
Yeah. Stop searching the place, okay?
I can't get advice from you, Cooperman. The OPP don't deal with hustlers. There's rules about buying outside help. I guess it wouldn't hurt just to talk, would it?
Uh-huh.
I was thinking, maybe George had a partner in his mind. Maybe they had a falling out. Maybe George saw him kill Aeneas.
Maybe that's a peck of maybes.
Take a look at that.
What is this?
Found it under George's body.
Do you mind if I, hold on to this, just for this morning?
Sure. Not that I trust you. You're not getting out of my sight.
Is that? Start. Stop the car. Thornton.
Hi, Benny.
Hi. Come here.
No, it's okay.
No, come here. Come here, I want to have a little talk with you, right? Just a little talk. Come here. I'm alive! Okay? I'm alive! No thanks to you, buddy. Pal! School chum!
Remember your bad back now.
People died up here, Ray. They were killed here.
I know. It's awful. Look, I got a check to cover your expenses.
I cannot be bought! Who's that guy?
That's my client.
What's he doing with her?
It's his wife. Oh, sorry. He didn't know about her and Patton. We didn't even know she was up here. Honest.
You know what you are, Ray? You know what you are. You're a... the check. Mr. Barber, get her to tell you the one about the impregnation of the Scarlet Woman. It's a killer.
Hello there, fella.
Oh, shh. Cooperman, you're bad luck. You get out of here.
No, just relax. You're going to rip a stitch. How you doing?
What are you doing here?
Oh, I just wanted to keep you up on world affairs, let you know what's happening. For example, George McCord, we know, was blackmailing a nice couple up at the lodge. Something to do with extramarital affairs, something that would have made big headlines.
Are you going to take all day
to
make a point?
No, I'm not. I just wanted to say I think George was also putting the bite on you.
What, do you think I haven't had to deal with extortionists before?
Oh, yeah, I think...
Where'd you get that thing?
No, I think this particular extortionist had something so hot, even he didn't know how hot it was,
Well, go on now. You're doing the talking.
The newspapers got hold of the fact that Norbert E. Patton many years ago was dabbling in Satanism. I mean, wouldn't that bring the pillars of the temple crashing down on your head and wipe you off the face of primetime TV?
Satanism? Me?
Your scarlet woman, Aileen Barber, she followed you to Little Crummock Lake. You know what she did? She ventilated my boat instead of yours. It was a mistake. Now,
take it easy with that thing. There's oxygen in here.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's just that this little tassel that fits so neatly into your lighter, this was found under the dead body of George McCord. You didn't watch yourself up here. You thought you were dealing with a bunch of hicks. Now, you killed George McCord.
Now, you think the only way to deal with a blackmailer is to put an axe in his head?
No. You're absolutely right. There's lots of ways, which is why I find it so interesting to hear you say he was killed with an axe. Nori, the lid was on tight. Nobody knew how he died. I even wondered how Lorca found out, but I guess you told her all the gory details, thinking that it was public knowledge. Wrong.
If that was supposed to be a trap, that was pathetic. What's going on here?
What do you want?
Nothing more. I think I've got enough to arrest this man.
Cooperman, I am ashamed of you.
Wait a minute, I had nothing to do with this nonsense. Glover, this is really dirty pool, all right?
Don't be sore, Benny.
You think this evidence will keep him for more than a weekend?
Maybe a long weekend.
One thing I want to tell you. A long time ago, when you saw a face at the old mill in the window, it wasn't the evil one. In fact, it was somebody rather likable. Old Dick Berners.
Cooperman, if you see Wilf and Spence on your way out, send them in here.
You're not allowed any visitors.
Mr. Cooperman, so you're really leaving us? Well, you'll have to come back and see us when all this has settled down.
I'd really like that.
Good. Well, make sure you write first. Ever since this broke in the papers, I'm booked straight through American Thanksgiving. I think I thought I was going to go broke, huh?
I'm very happy for you.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Cooperman, take care of yourself.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Okay.
No, wait, Lloyd and Sissy, they gave you this huge lake trout. Let me just get it for you.
Joan! Okay. Here's the thing.
Yes, Mr. Cooperman.
I just have to go up the road a piece first, and I'll be back for the fish, okay?
You have to go up the road a piece, Mr. Cooperman?
Yeah.
I'm glad this hasn't all been wasted on you.
Okay. Maybe if we had this to do over again, you people would let me know that you knew who Norbert E. Patton was, you knew about the satanic rites in the mill, then maybe my stay here would be shortened just... That's the thing. Okay.
That's fine. Good. That's fair.
That's Complete. The thing.
That's fair. Perfectly fair. Maybe next time you'll let us know you're a private detective from the big city, not just a fisherman.
You thought I was a fisherman, huh?
No, I thought you were a lumberjack. You come on back for the fish, huh?
Maggie?
I've been expecting you. Forgive the mess. I've not been well.
I know.
You think so? Really think so?
I don't know.
Let me tell you something. I've had it good. I've lived a long time, and
I've always floated to the top. I've been lucky, and I've been loved. Do you want a drink? I've run out of tea. Albert was a good man. Everybody loved Albert. Albert loved me. Poor me. So silly. So stupid. And so willful. So in love with Dick Berners, I couldn't keep my hands off you. Oh, you couldn't understand this. But he wouldn't touch me while Albert was still alive. If you intend to have affairs, never marry a man other people respect.
I see. All you have left of him now is a gold mine. Is that right?
Oh, wherever I went in life, Dick Barnes was just ahead. Oh, he was a body.
You know they arrested Norbert Patton for killing your son? You know that?
They should hang him. If there's any justice, they should hang him.
Justice? Where exactly is the justice in letting George take the blame for what you did? Aeneas was going to expose your little mine. George was way too drunk to do anything about it. But you always looked out for George, didn't you? And Aeneas had to die.
So?
You said goodnight to us. You went home. You took your boat with the silent motor. You paid Aeneas' camp a little visit. He trusted you. He wouldn't have turned his back on George, but you. You hit him over the back of the head. You dragged his body to the flooded creek. And it's George's name on the police file. They think he did it.
You think you know something, but you don't.
You know, you pulled George out of a lot of scrapes in the past, but he really pulled you out of this one.
Talk! That's all it is, just talk.
The satanic business. Berners told you all about that a long time ago, right? When Patton came back, you put little Georgie up to blackmail him.
You're turning all my swans to geese, young man.
I'm not out to prove anything, Maggie.
No, Benny. I was thinking of poisoning you. But I resisted the temptation. I'm a wicked old woman, surrounded by the ghosts of her men, the strong ones and the weak ones. And the one I wanted, I couldn't have. I was young. I broke hearts across the room. It was wonderful. Now get out of here before I change my mind. Think of me sometimes when you eat a piece of cake or with that last scoop of sugar in your cup of tea.
I didn't stop to pick up Lloyd's lake trout. I'd seen enough wildlife for a while. And that included the beavers at the culvert. Up to their old tricks.